the main character of One Night Markovitch is Yakov Markovitch. And I like this character because this is a character that nobody would usually write about. He's the sort of guy that nobody looks at when he walks in the street because he has nothing interesting in his face, no interesting feature. And I like the idea of taking this man that nobody ever bothers to look at and to ask what happened when this man suddenly gains power over a woman. Because what happens in the story is that Markovitch is sent from pre-mandatory Palestine into Europe in this really heroic operation that goes terribly wrong. He's sent to Europe to rescue Jewish women from Nazi Germany. And the idea is he's supposed to get married to them, but fictively married. And then when they reach Israel, when they reach Palestine, they get divorced. And this way the women are saved from Nazi Germany. But when he reaches Nazi Germany, he meets this amazingly beautiful woman called Bella. And though he's supposed only to fictively marry her and get divorced the minute they reach Israel, when he gets to Israel, he feels that he can't let go of her. She's so beautiful and he's such this ordinary man that nobody ever looks at, and he feels that he has to hold her by force. He can't let this woman just walk out of his life. And for me, it was to write a novel about love, about obsession, about what makes one man hold another person by force. I was fascinated by it. Because I like the idea of putting two different kinds of manhood in front of each other. So on the one hand, you have Markovitch, who is like a caricature of the Jewish man. He's very thin and slender and very unmemorable and unhandsome. And then you have Zev Feinberg, which is like the ultimate masculine man, the absolute dream of Zionism. You have this man who's very powerful, very sensual. He has this huge mustache that walks in front of him, and everybody, you know, you see the mustache mile before you see the man behind the mustache. And Markovitch is drawn to this man, but I think in a way he's also jealous, because when you have this couples, this male couples of the man who has everything and his friends that always walk a little bit behind, and he sees Zev Feinberg with women, he sees Zev Feinberg walks in life, and everybody, Feinberg is this kind of guy that when he starts to speak, people fall silent. He doesn't have to tell them to be silent. They know that they have to be silent because they want to listen to him. And Markovitch is the kind of man that if he wants to say something, then it will take him about 10 minutes to get everybody to lower their voice and just give him this one moment of look, of the gaze into his face. And yeah, they go together to this journey to save the woman, and they go together back to Israel. It was very important to me to have something which is humorous and vivid and sensual and sexy in a way, because I didn't want to write a history book. It's not a historical novel. It's set in an historical time, but it's not a historical novel because I think dates and facts are less important than the taste of the tongue of the person you want to kiss. So for me, whenever I had to choose between fact and smells or tastes, I went to that side. And I think usually when we read about World War II in history books, and of course war is not a funny thing, but then you think people made love during wartime and people laughed during wartime and they had dreams and fears and just like we have today. And for me, it was part of the thing that fascinated me in writing this novel, was to take these really serious pictures in black and white that we have from this area and say, okay, so what happens behind the scenes of the pictures? Like if you have everybody looking very, very seriously, like in the Declaration of Israel, you have, I think, 20 men sitting very, very seriously. I always thought, well, what about if one of these guys really needs to go to the toilet, but he can't go because everybody have to sit there and wait for the picture. And maybe the guy over there, he's really jealous because he wanted to be in the front, but he's sticking the, like the little things that make us human behind the big picture that is history. I actually met my protagonist when I came to this really boring meeting of the parents in the village. I was supposed to meet the parents of my partner in a village in the north of Israel. And I came there, it was a really boring conversation, just gazed outside. And then I saw this house behind the fence. It was really dark. It was a sunny day, but the house was dark. And there was this some kind of sadness coming out of the house. Like other houses, you have this, the smell of barbecue coming out of them. And there you have this sadness, and I asked who lives there, like what's going on there. And then everybody told me, beautiful Bella lives there. So I immediately said, who's beautiful Bella? And then I realized that beautiful Bella is over 80, but they keep calling her beautiful Bella, because even though the story was more than 50 years old, it shocked the village so much that they held on to the story. They told the story from one generation into another. So that beautiful Bella, the woman that was married just to save her from Germany and then was forcibly held, she's now 80 years old. And the villain that did it to her, this bad man, because the whole village hated him for doing it, he was already dead. But they kept the story alive for so many years. And I was fascinated by it. I thought, wow, I mean, you have this woman living there, the whole village knows the story and talks about it, he's already dead. And the first thing I thought was, what makes a man do such a thing? Because at first I thought that she will be the hero, I thought the story will be about her, but then I thought, I want to know about him. I'm a psychologist, so I'm really fascinated by human beings and by human mentality. And I thought, what kind of man goes and does that? And the basic response would be a bad man, but that's just too easy to call him a bad man. And I thought, what if it's not a bad man? What if it's one of the guys that go to high school with you, but you never remember their name? One day after you finish school, you don't remember their name. And then he gets this amazing woman, and he knows that he'll never have a chance to be happy again afterwards. Can we still blame him for doing that?